Hi, and welcome to Hidden Assets, and I am Chris, and with me is a special guest. This is Brian from SanSan Francisco.
Hi, thanks for having me on.
Hey, thanks for coming on, man. I appreciate it. So we are casting the final round of Swiss for the Math and Stuff Store Tournament, and this is Thomas on the left playing Blue Sun. We've seen him on camera a little bit before, or you haven't, Brian, but we just cast him before, and on the right is James, who I ended up playing in the second round, and he's back on table one and playing.
And it looks like he is laying out a bunch of cards right now.
Yeah, Sure Gamble, Dirty Laundry, Data Sucker, and a Desperado. So he is doing what Andy does and start with a bunch of good stuff.
Start off strong.
Yep.
Blue Sun here prepping some remote servers. Interesting.
Yeah, that's kind of a different sort of strategy to start off the game. I don't know. Thomas is an interesting player. He likes to play each kind of game differently. I've noticed, like, the last game we cast, he kind of did a similar thing, but then the first game we cast with him, he had a kind of standard Blue Sun sort of structure of his build. So looks like James has ran on R&D and hit a hive, and now he's running on HQ and a no res.
And he put down the R&D interface early there to really pressure that hive res, which was smart.
Yeah, it's a really good play. Oh, man. So he hits the NAPD and then legworks right back in, knowing that Thomas has no defenses. And he's going to see all three cards in his hand. And all right, he gets another agenda. Is that the... I always forget that one. I haven't seen that one for a long time since Core. Is that right?
Is that a? Is it Corporate War?
Corporate War. Yeah, that's right. So if the corporation scores it with 7 credits in their pool, they gain 7. But if they score it with less than 7, they lose all the credits in their pool.
And that one's really good in Blue Sun because they can pull back something like a hive right before scoring it and make sure that they are up on credits.
Right. Right.
And did he just res an asset there?
Yeah, he resed the root and used the root.
The root, all right.
And used it to res Hive. So Hive got shut down by James.
It's interesting. I wonder why he didn't res it the first time that the Hive got resed.
I don't know. Maybe he didn't. Oh, he didn't have any money. He must have just resed... I think he had 5 credits exactly, and he got broke, and so that's why I lost all those. Yeah, yeah. He's sitting on about 5 credits now, and James is a bit broke himself, so now it's the time for the corp to kind of kick it up a notch.
Yeah, the Wayland's definitely low on credits compared to what you're used to seeing here, thanks to early criminal pressure.
So James is going to take some Katie money? And he's going to run at that root and hits a hive. Man, 2 hives. All right.
Well, he picked up that. Didn't he pick up that hive?
Oh, you're right. He did. That's a caduceus.
And that's an interesting combo there. Like picking up something like a hive when you've rezzed it with the root, you're actually making a profit.
So James gets into R&D, sees 2 cards, and nothing there. I see a Jackson as the second card. It's good for the corp, but James does not have the money to trash that, which is always a bit annoying. I love trashing the Jackson.
Got to trash the Jackson.
Yep. How have you played with the root a lot, or how have you found it?
You know, I'm not a big Wayland player myself for no particular reason. I just haven't really played them a lot, so no, I have not played with the root too much.
Yeah, I haven't either, actually. I know we have a really dedicated Wayland player, Steven, who does the cast with me most of the time. He loves Wayland. It's like his first corp. And I know he's experimented with the root. But I haven't personally either. But it's been doing a lot of work for Thomas this game.
It makes a lot of sense for Blue Sun as well, when you could kind of turn it into drip econ at the right time.
Right.
Yeah, it's smart.
And so what Thomas just did there is he res the Adonis campaign and then gained the 3 credits and then use the Blue Sun ability to bounce it back to hand, so getting a temporary boost of 4 credits, which is pretty good.
Right, yeah, he's what, using the route to res the Adonis on that as well, right?
That's right.
Yeah, that's really good.
And now we've got a OAI'd Hadrian's Wall on R&D, so criminal's not getting in there just yet. Gonna have to do a little bit of work.
Yeah, what is the criminal's credit pool at right now?
Looks like he just dirty laundried archives, so he's gonna be at 5.
Okay.
A bunch of data sucker tokens.
He has a lot of data suckers. Yeah, if he did have a Corroder in hand, he could bust through that, but it seems unlikely.
Yeah, I see a Yogg, and I see a Siphon, so there may be some siphoning in the future, but he's got to be worried now with all of that corp money of getting scorched.
Yeah, definitely want to get an answer to Scorch Earth pretty soon.
Yeah.
I've not seen a lot of card drawing on the runner side. Have I just been missing that, or is it mostly just been focused on running, it seems like?
I think it's been focused on running. I think he's mainly been just pressuring the centrals, trying to keep the corp poor, but
yeah.
You know, there's only so much of that you can actually get away with before the corp pulls ahead, especially Blue Sun.
Yeah, you need to develop your own board state at some point. That's a lesson I'm learning as a runner continuously. You know, I'm a very aggressive runner, and I'm really learning lately to kind of pull things back a bit and develop your board state.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the game is kind of an ebb and flow, right? And you got to identify those build turns and then those run turns, right?
So. I don't know if Andromeda has it, but John Massanori here would have been major in the earlier part of the game here. Oh,
absolutely, yeah. So, takes money from Katie.
I see at least 6 data suckers.
Oh, yeah. 6 data suckers, about 6 credits, and a Yogg. So, the Yogg is going to get him through the data pike on HQ, which is pretty decent. Oh, and he trashes a reversed account. So that's something we only recently got from the source. Is that correct, or was it the previous pack?
You know, I can't remember. It's one of the two.
Yeah,
but it is certainly a new card.
We don't see it very much.
It's got to make you wonder, in this matchup, when there's a lot of assets going down, probably some more traps happening here.
Yeah, absolutely. Thomas has an interesting eclectic mix of assets here. Which is cool. Like, it's really interesting to see. This was just after All That Remains came out, and people were still experimenting with the new cards. One of the things we learned from this tournament is Daily Business Show is one of the best assets in the game.
Oh, yeah. It's a must trash, you know, even more than Jackson Howard in some ways.
Yeah, I agree. Jackson keeps you from losing, but Daily Business Show wins you the game, so...
Yeah, especially if they have Daily Business Show on their deck, it probably means they have some sort of combo they're trying to get, and you need to take care of that very quickly.
Yeah.
So he just keeps popping back that Adonis campaign, huh?
Yeah, it's kind of a cool... I mean, especially if you don't have any ice to use your ability on, it's a nice way to kind of, you know, get a couple extra credits and use it. So it's a really cool play from Thomas.
So I think that makes you, what, 3 credits usually, but with the root, that's bringing him in 6? Does that sound right?
So let's see. He reses it for 4, gains 3, and then brings it back for 4. So he nets 6?
Yeah, that's really good. And Andromeda is not really trashing it when she could get in there.
No. But he does find his Plascrete, and he's now a little bit more content to kind of run roughshod over this Blue Sun deck, it looks like. James draws a little bit and kind of pondering his options here.
And, you know, we haven't seen a lot of influence here out of the Blue Sun deck yet. So there's still some possibility for maybe mid-season at this point. Something to be aware of as a runner.
Yeah, absolutely. Other than the Adonis campaign, right? Adonis is... 2, I think.
We've seen the Adonis and the 3? Jackson Howard, right?
Right, Adonis, Jackson Howard.
I think the Adonis is 2 influence.
Okay. I believe that's all I've seen, too. Looks like he's going to install an agenda in that remote and advance it. So we've got a scoring remote. What does...
And that definitely... That definitely looks like an NAPD to me. Probably. Yeah. What, are there two ice on that remote?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, I mean, NAPD or Corporate War make a lot of sense there.
James has the potential. I don't know if he can get in here. Maybe if he siphons first, he might be able to get in. But it's hard to make that call here. Looks like he's just going to take some money, put some money on Katie, and
that could be the Grendel refinery agenda. What's that one called?
A geothermal fracking?
Yeah, fracking. That's right, fracking.
Yeah, it could be. Uh-oh. So Corp purges, and now what do you do as the runner?
Wow, that's interesting. You think? I wonder why he didn't just score out the agenda there.
He must not have felt very threatened, I think. He must have something that James couldn't get by.
Right. There could be a barrier and then like something like the data pike or Enigma, so maybe just clearing the virus is, you know.
Yeah.
No, I guess the Yogg would still get through. I don't know.
It's a pretty solid play, though, if you expect Andromeda to be doing a lot of like archives running, because now archives is sealed up. And, you know, I did see a Taurus in his hand. I'm not sure if he installed it, but that would definitely set him back, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Taurus would be pretty good. So he has the Fem on that front ice there.
And that's a Hadrian's Wall. Yep. So he's just going to pay two to get through.
Did he res it?
He did res it, yeah.
Wow. Okay. I guess that makes sense. He can just pull it back as Blue Sun. Yeah, Blue Sun is so weird economically. I'm just not used to... Like, that's such a weird res, but if you're Blue Sun, that makes sense.
Yeah, do you think that Blue Sun actually gets ahead economically, or do you think it just kind of, like, gets bursts of money and kind of stays status quo?
I don't know if I could generalize Blue Sun that way. I mean, this Blue Sun deck, he's clearly making money off of the combination of his ability... And that route, he's making money.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But, yeah, I mean, Blue Sun, like you say, Blue Sun can just kind of sit there and be... If you're just popping ice back and forth, you're not really making any money. But it's also great for this type of thing where you got a Fem on the table. You could just clean that Hadrian's Wall right off.
Yeah, you can. And that's what he does. Oh, man.
Yeah, the Parasites and Fem are so popular, it's great to have a built-in ability to deal with that type of program.
And looks like Thomas has had enough of the R&D shenanigans, and he shells up R&D pretty good. Man, yeah. He's got tons of money. Look at that. Holy crap. 23. Oh, my
It's
goodness.
A little bit hard for me to tell over how many he has, but what is it, like 30 credits?
Yeah, it's over 30 credits.
Yeah, he has enough. He should probably start scoring out agendas.
I think maybe that's 39
that
credits.
Might not be in an agenda there.
No, I think it is. I think it is. Really? Yeah, I think it is. I saw it put down, but I think that he's just slow rolling it. Like, he doesn't actually care if he scores an APD. I have a feeling like right now, yep, so he scores the NAPD, and then what? What you got? Looks like he's going to hedge fund, maybe? I don't know.
Does he have another click? I thought he had to advance that three times there.
I think he advanced it twice before.
Oh, okay.
So he was slow advancing it.
Got it.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. That makes sense. NAPD, he knew outside of something like a stim hack, even if the runner could get in that server, he wasn't going to have enough credits to steal it.
Yeah.
That's totally reasonable.
Yeah, yeah. No security testing on Andy's side is really what's hurting her right now. Like, you really want to see those early.
Yeah, especially against all these assets out. There's still some face downs there. Whatever's below Jackson Howard.
I think that's another copy of the route, and I think James just checked it and said, oh, well, I'm not going to trash that. Like, there's no point. I guess that's true. There really isn't a point. So we got a res Adonis campaign, and Thomas just drew his Atlas. So, yeah, he's sitting pretty good right now.
So he's going to let that Adonis campaign sit another turn and then probably try and score out the Atlas, it looks like.
Right.
That seems good.
Yeah.
I approve.
Blue Sun doing what Blue Sun does.
Yeah, and like you pointed out, no security testing, no outside of Katie Jones, no real economy here on the runner side.
Yeah,
It's too expensive now to get into the servers to make that desperado pay you.
Yeah, even the quasi economy of data sucker isn't really getting him where he wants right now. But we will see a Corroder go down, so that's good. And he'll run through the ice wall on R&D and hits a Hadrian's wall, and he's seen that before. It's just
Hadrian's Wall. It's about the third time it's been resisted.
Yeah, yeah, with very little economic impact to the corp. That's scary.
Yeah, the corp just doesn't care. The root helping out.
Yeah.
Wow.
So looks like he bounces, and he's just gonna check the remote and sees an executive boot camp. That's one of my favorite cards. Yeah. Oh man. I love that card so much. It's so great.
Yeah, that one really works out with Blue Sun as well.
Especially if you're playing kind of one-off assets and you just really, you know, need one really immediately. Find a Jackson, find an Adonis in this deck, or a Root, you know.
One of Snare, maybe.
One of Snare, yeah. If you want to be evil, really, really
evil. Well, you're gonna come into HQ, let me just go get an asset here and come on in. Right. So did he trash it?
It does look like he trashed it, yeah. And, oh, well, we've got two cards in that remote. Looked like an Ash to me and the Atlas. So,
okay.
Very solid play. James is having some trouble contesting these remotes, so that's a really good play.
He has the Breaker Suite online now. He probably just needs some more data suckers. And what's his economy at right now? How many credits do we have here?
I think he has 13 credits. So those stacks are stacks of three, I believe, from Katie. Yep. And okay. Then just one extra credit. So he's got 13 credits and one data sucker token. Yeah, not bad. He can get through.
And he has his Plast Greed out.
So barring the triple Scorch play... he's probably okay here for a little while, so.
Yeah.
Yep, he can just get through.
I am still curious if there's not mid-seasons in the deck, but.
Yeah, I didn't see, in our last game with Thomas, he was playing a more traditional Sea Scorch sort of build, where he didn't have mid-seasons. He was just playing a single Scorch, a single Sea Source. Maybe two. But yeah, not
with the NAPDs in, I'm wondering if maybe he doesn't even have geothermal. Maybe those NAPDs are taking the geothermal slot.
Yeah, I think that's a good assumption. I haven't seen one in the three games. I think Thomas has been on camera, so yep. So James is going in HQ and sees the Scorched Earth. Yep, that's what you expect. Okay.
Good to know.
Yeah, good to know. Yep. So do you just reasonably assume, like, as I do when you're playing against Blue Sun, that they always have Scorched in hand, like, and just play around it?
Yeah. I mean, I think you just have to make that assumption. It's so good. I mean, just playing against Waylon, yeah. Scorched is such a good card that it's kind of crazy not to assume they don't have it, I guess.
Right. It could lead to your death, as it... Actually, a couple games ago, it did indeed lead to my death. And I was on camera.
Yeah, you could just lose the game. It's a good thing to defend against. I mean, it definitely, there's times where you really don't want to install that Plast Greed. You're like, I bet they don't have the combo yet, but right. You should just do it.
So we have a triple over advanced Atlas scored now.
Ooh, that's bad.
That's really bad, yeah.
Do you know if he has Hostile Takeovers in the deck?
I don't think he's playing Hostile Takeovers. I think he's playing more of a slow Glacial 2/3.
And he's trying to avoid the bad pub, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he would have this game in three turns if he did, but...
Yeah. But he can still... I mean, that remote is still uncontested, which is a big deal, so...
It at this point, I think it really depends what that ice is and if he could get some more ice on that remote. And then he could hopefully find a 5/3 and score it out.
Right.
He's going to look for something.
Yep. He's going to go grab a Pryrak. He's just going to end this game. I think he's just ready to...
Did he just show the Pryrak to the runner?
Yeah. He didn't have to.
He didn't have to. He's just... This is what's happening.
Yeah, I'm not sure why I did that.
That's a bold play right there.
Yep.
You know, that's definitely going to be a trap in that remote now. Watch. He's going to put the aggressive secretary down. Yeah. Don't run. That's an aggressive secretary.
Yep. Oh, man. But we did see him actually put the Pryrec down. He's just basically ready for this to be over, go to the next game. That's putting a lot of pressure on the runner. He just knows he's basically broke. Like, he just doesn't have his econ engine online.
I don't know. There's only two pieces of ice. He could conceivably do this. He could get in once and trash the ash, and then if he could just get in again.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, maybe try. I mean, what have you got to lose in a way?
It's worth a shot. I can't imagine what ice is there that, you know.
And unfortunately, he's going to go run R&D instead, and Thomas goes and pulls his other three fives to hand, which is a pretty good play. Yeah, yeah, very smart.
What click was that he's running in?
I believe it's last click. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that's game, and there's the Pryrec.
He just guaranteed that the runner couldn't get the win right there.
Yeah. Oh man. Well, that's part one of our last game of Swiss, and we'll be back with the next part in just a moment. And we're back, and we've switched sides. Thomas is now playing Andromeda, and James is playing Near Earth Hub. Oh boy, how do you feel about this matchup?
The classic matchup.
Yeah.
Yep. This has been the matchup that we've been seeing for the past, I don't know, 6 months. Ooh, or so.
Ooh, double sweeps week, ice.
That's what you want on ice over HQ. Perfect.
Yep, that's perfect. That is probably the best opening hand that NEH can have against Andy right there. Double sweep.
You know, it depends what that ice is.
Yeah, I guess so.
Like, you want it to be like a wraparound or an enigma.
Right, right. Maybe, probably not
Eli. A
pop-up
could be bad.
Yeah. Oh. Well. No nonsense. Thomas is all, okay, fine. Fairy, security testing, dirty laundry, whatever. Same normal stuff I always do. Yep.
No, I mean, I think that, like, people really thought that sweep streak might have put Drama to knock her down a few notches, but it really didn't seem to matter that much.
No.
Which is just a testament to how good Andromeda is.
Yeah, absolutely.
Looks like a lot of running is happening right now.
Yep. James gets a bit of siphoning, or gets siphoned rather, and reses a daily business show. Looks like he's deciding between a Biotic and an Eli, and takes the Eli. It's probably a good play here. How do you feel about, like, which cards do you usually grab when you daily business show? Like, does it depend on what stage of the game you're in? How do you go about deciding that?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. At this point, taking the Eli over the Biotic makes a lot of sense, because he just probably doesn't have an Astro script yet to combo with the Biotic, right?
Right.
And he's also very exposed to more siphons, so it's good to shore that up.
Yep. There's an Architect.
Oh, great.
Oof.
So is this just a normal HQ run right here?
Looks like just a normal HQ run.
Yeah. Yeah, that's that Architect. So good.
Rolling the dice. Sees a quandary. Nothing. There is a Beal in hand. Wow. There is a Beal in hand.
So did he have a fairy to break that Architect?
Yeah, he used his fairy.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yes, I just missed that. Sorry.
That's right.
That's great though. That's really gonna slow the runner down a little bit until he can get something like a Mimic online.
Man, Architect just changed the game so much.
Yeah, you know, there was a period of time where you weren't really seeing Mimic in Criminal decks too much, and then Architect swept in right around the time of Worlds, and everyone was running Mimic.
Yeah. Well, I remember even Kate decks were running just Femme at one point, and they weren't even running Mimic. They were just running Femme. It's really bizarre, but... Yep. So, right. Oh, man. Runs into HQ, R&D, steals a Beal off the top, and then shuts down... I'm sorry, he ran an HQ. Shuts down the Architect.
Architect and gets a Beal.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
It's a good turn.
Yeah, and in this matchup against Near Earth Hub, you're probably not going to see anything much more expensive than 4 or 5 credits. So that's a good shutdown.
Yeah.
That's basically denying your opponent a hedge fund.
And he's got another one, it looks like, in the off chance that James can res like a toll booth or something.
So. Sure. He might even have same old things.
Yeah. I think it's a semi-standard Andy deck, though he's playing the supplier instead. Yeah, so it's a pretty cool build. I've seen a couple of supplier Andy builds, and they're really good. They're just more money for Andy, pretty much.
Yeah, and that's just Andy, that early game Andy setup really helps with the supplier, because you want to see the supplier like turn one or two.
Right.
So I might not even need hostage in that case.
So James is going to... He fast-tracks his Astro script and takes a couple credits, I believe, and just passes the turn.
Wow. So what's the Corp's credit pull at?
The Corp is at 6. So he's going to res that Architect, Ben.
Man, what's he going to do with that Astro script?
I don't know, man. Look for a quandary, maybe, and try to put... it's so risky to try and do shenanigans like that against Criminal, though. Like, one ice agendas just don't really work against Criminal.
This is a siphon coming in, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. This is bad.
Yeah, this is bad.
Although that Architect is still helping out a little bit.
Let's see. So he's gonna install probably from HQ, I imagine. The quandary? No. He declines. All right.
Yeah, sometimes you just don't have a good target.
Yep, and Thomas chooses to access.
Oh, interesting.
I think that's a good choice. He only had 2 credits, so...
Sure. And you know he has the Astroscript.
Yep.
Yeah, that's reasonable. The siphon might have even just been to really encourage the Corp to res that ice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just to slow down the... Because the Biotic Labor score was... Probably not going to happen that turn, but it probably wasn't too far away the turn after.
Whoa! We've got 2 daily business shows on James's side. And, yeah. So he's going to find everything he needs now, hopefully.
So he draws 3 and then keeps 1, right?
Right.
Yep. That makes sense.
And credit. Credit, and install an ice. Over the archives? He's thinking.
Yeah. Yeah, that's probably the quandary. He's protecting the daily business show?
Yeah.
I don't know about that. I think over archives was the better call there, because you have that security testing data sucker combo up and running.
Yeah, that's true. Although getting your daily business shows trashed is kind of annoying. And I think that's what Thomas was going to do. Yeah, there goes 1. So.
It is, but the archives running is... allowing the runner to trash the daily business shows.
Yeah, that's very true. And Thomas has an answer to that in hand anyway, so, man. He's got a Gordian Blade. Actually, he's got all of his breakers. Yeah. He's got another fairy. Yeah, so it's looking pretty scary right now.
And until that archives gets defended, he's got his econ. Oh, so the Corp is going to trash the security testing? Is that what he's thinking?
I think he's thinking about it.
Oh, there's no tags, though. We haven't had a siphon. Or does he have the siphon tags? I can't tell.
No, I don't see them. Either they're keeping track in their minds, or I don't think they do. I think the last time he siphoned, he accessed in the one before it. I think it just ran into a wraparound. So no successful siphons so far.
Okay. Got it.
That's probably a wise choice, too. Using them to res ice is fine. Like, I actually really like doing that. You just got to find what that ice is so you can go special order your breaker, man. But,
So the Corp doesn't have a Biotic Labor, I'm guessing?
No, he does.
He does, okay.
But he only had 6 credits, though.
Oh, so he's always 1 credit off here.
Right. But now he's got 7 with the pop-up window.
Now he's ready to go. The pop-up is perfect there. That's great.
And Thomas is going to bank job that remote and gain a bunch of money. That's pretty scary.
Yeah. Man. Profit of 7 credits there for 2 clicks. Not right. bad. And he could get through and trash that daily business show.
That's right. And looks like he looked at an ice and a hedge fund. Decides to go for the ice. He's going to biotic labor and shipment from SanSan. That's 5 credits for an Astro script. Seems pretty solid, man.
Yeah, that shipment from SanSan really doing work right there.
I love it at NEH. I played it in this tournament as well, and it was the MVP of this game for me. Or not this game, but my previous games. And James and I talked a little bit about it, and he said it just like there's so much siphon in our meta that
it was right. worth it. It's a really good counter to that. Yeah, it's I think once Sweep Suite came out, you stopped seeing a lot of NBN with SanSan. But yeah, that makes a lot of sense. If you're getting siphoned a lot, you're going down to 0 credits, but you have an Astro script.
Yep.
That will do the trick.
Also, my sparring partner for this tournament, Steven, who we were talking about this last game, he was playing a central siphon deck, and so he was just like, the whole thing was, if I end up playing you, I really want to be able to win. So I put a couple of SanSans, shipment from SanSans in there, and it was so good. So what do we got going on here? Looks like
moving the security testing to the quandary.
Yeah,
that's makes sense.
Yeah,
it's not as profitable in the sense that you don't get the data sucker, but you're not also giving the corp a credit, so that's better.
Yeah, partially why NEH is so good is it can just score agendas off of very little money, so keeping them on close to nothing is what you really got to do. It's even though it's not that much profit, it's not very profitable. It's kind of disappointing, actually, security testing that. But we've got a sweep week, so James is going to sweep week and pass the turn.
The criminal, the runner right now, I think really needs to get some accesses here, especially on R&D.
Yeah.
So hopefully that's what we're going to start seeing here.
And he does. He runs R&D. Looks like he's going to trash something. He's trashing the pad campaign. Does he go back in? He does.
Yeah. Yeah.
And nothing.
And no Desperado yet either. That's upsetting for Andromeda.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, when I was thinking about that security testing, I was thinking about it in terms of Desperado, so...
Yeah, it's really good with Desperado, but getting through the quandary, you mean?
Yeah, I was thinking, oh, you're getting 2 credits for that, but that was assuming you had the Desperado out. Without the Desperado, not as good.
Right. Yeah. So James is going to hedge fund, install some ice over R&D, and I believe take a credit.
Yeah, this is exactly what he needs to be doing. He just needs to defend up R&D until he can draw another Astro script, basically.
Yep.
And it was definitely smart of the runner to get rid of that daily business show, especially now that an Astro script is scored.
And he reses an architect over R&D, and Thomas is going to use his fairy. Seems solid.
Yes.
Yeah. Pays through Eli, and we're going to get a final res. We will. It's a wraparound. And that keeps him out. There is...
Oh,
that's a sad Andy right there.
Did that zero out the corpse accounts too?
Yeah, it did. Oh, he's got 1 credit. 1 credit.
Oh, okay.
it's pretty close.
It would have been poetic if both of them went down to 0 on that. Especially if the next card was a Astro script.
Yeah.
Looks like he maybe drew an NAPD.
Yeah, he did. So he's got at least 3 agendas in hand now: a Beal or 2, and an NAPD. So, yeah, he definitely wants to score these things as fast as possible. There's breaking news.
That's good.
Yep.
He might have put that NAPD in the archives, unless you can see in his hand. I'm not sure.
I can't tell. I can't tell. Yeah. So he's going to score that breaking news. Deciding whether he wants to draw? He does. Okay.
Yeah, it's not optional. He has to draw, right?
Ooh. Uses the Astroscript token to trash the supplier.
I don't know about that. Well, I don't know about that.
That's bold. I mean, Andy's broke, though.
Yeah.
So...
There was nothing on the supplier, was there?
There was. There was an RDI.
Oh, an RDI. Okay. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah,
yeah, okay. that seems kind of crazy to me to do that, but you know, maybe it'll work out.
Desperate times call for desperate measures in this case. I don't know.
Because that supplier is, you know, it's relatively slow econ. It's not bursty. So as NEH, I think I would rather just try and go look for another AstroScript, but I guess he probably has another biotic labor in hand by now, huh?
Yeah, he does. A biotic and a shipment.
Okay. Okay, so he just needs to get a little bit more money, and then, you know, okay, maybe that was more reasonable than I'm thinking.
So he's going to put a pop-up window over Archives, so now Archives is effectively shut off.
Yeah, you don't want to go messing around in there.
Yeah, giving the corp 2 credits seems like a bad idea. There's some business show, or not, Daily Caster? Yep, sorry.
Yeah. Okay, that supplier destruction was pretty well timed, I have to give the corp credit. Almost like he knew.
I don't know. Maybe he had some sort of insider information, but that was a really, really solid play. And corp is just going to money up and pass the turn.
You know, I think time will still tell if that was the right play or not, but it wasn't. It seemed totally insane to me at first. I was like, what are you doing? Spending the Astro here, and you know, we'll see how that plays out. It was certainly a bold play.
It was. I kind of like it. I really like using you know, non-conventional plays like to trash resources. It's just so versatile. Like, breaking news is great. In an earlier game, round two, I used biotic breaking news to trash his James's 9 credit, Katie Jones. So,
yeah,
that was,
you know, pretty good play. I wish I could say I haven't been on the receiving end of that before, but it just wouldn't be true.
Yeah, it's demoralizing. It feels awful.
Yeah, it's really. You're like, okay, I'm gonna put one more use on Katie here, and I could get 12 credits next turn. It's gonna be great.
Yeah,
nope. Ship him from SanSan Breaking News.
Ship him from SanSan Breaking News. Interesting.
The only reason I could think to do that is just so the runner doesn't randomly get it out of HQ.
Yeah, I think that's got to be the reason. I wouldn't have been my choice there, but he did draw an Astro off of the install. So next turn he can biotic. He's looking pretty good, actually, all of a sudden.
But he used his shipment from SanSan, right? So now he needs some more credits.
Yeah, let's see. He's got 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So he could... He could buy. Oh,
he could do it.
Astro.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't realize he was up that much.
Yeah, my crappy internet connection. Sorry about that, Brian.
Oh, it's okay. We're making do here.
So Thomas finds his Desperado. So yeah, I mean, he would have made a lot of bucks off of that supplier right now. There's a third daily cast.
Okay, he will have money. And I think this is what the runner's doing here. It makes a lot of sense, especially with that Astro token gone. It buys you a little bit of time.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't know that they have another biotic labor in hand.
Right. And a bunch of things to score. So now we're at 6 points and game point.
And now those daily casts maybe don't seem as wise.
Yeah. He has not been able to find his reliable Sentry Breaker this game, and he did find his special order, Thomas, but it was too little too late at this point. Like, do you just crash through HQ?
Yeah, he needed that mimic several turns ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's in a really bad position here.
Well, NEH can just turn those tables really fast. And he is going to, I believe, special order for Femme. All right.
For Femme, okay. Wow, how many credits does he have?
He has 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So
12.
At least he's going to get one access from HQ, it looks like. Or maybe he'll go digging in R&D. I don't know. What would you do here?
I don't know. I mean, so what do we have in R&D? We have a architect, Eli, and a wraparound.
And a wraparound, correct.
Yeah. Hmm. The R&D is expensive no matter where you put that fem token.
Yeah. He might not have the credits to actually get into R&D at all, so maybe just go HQ?
Yeah, I think at this point you might have to just put it on HQ and hope to get lucky.
He has a legwork. Can he do it?
And he does have a data sucker too, so that helps a lot on architects.
Oh, doesn't he just takes a credit and passes the turn and that's game. Yep.
Yeah, so he had the Beal in hand, huh?
Yeah, he was one credit off. Oh, he was one credit off.
He was one credit off from the legwork?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's brutal.
Yeah, I think he was just hoping, like, maybe he doesn't have it, you know? Oh, they always have it.
He probably spent a little bit too much time building up those daily casts there on, like, the second, third to last turn.
Yeah.
But outside of that, he was doing the right stuff. You just needed to get more accesses on R&D, probably.
Yeah, I agree. It tends to be, like, late game, and I have this problem, too, like, how do I go about rebuilding once I've, like, spent all my credits getting into R&D or HQ? Like, how do I keep that balance going, right? So it's a tough game mentally for me because of that. Like, I always play Nasir. I'm a Nasir player, and it's always hard for Nasir to keep money. But, yeah, there you go. So
that's a tough matchup for Nasir there with a Near Earth Hub.
It is, yeah. So Thomas and James split, and I guess I could say this now. This is the last round of Swiss, but Thomas ended up taking this tournament down. He got first place. Steven, who we saw in the last video, got second with his Foundry and Central Siphon Andromeda. And I got third with Nasir Near Earth Hub, so that was pretty cool.
Oh, congratulations.
Yeah, thanks, man. Thomas was undefeated until he played last game prior to this, sorry, and they split. They did a corpse split, I believe. So he only lost two games the whole tournament, which is really solid for his Andy and Blue Sun.
Wow! And how many rounds were in this tournament?
There were just five. It was a fairly small tournament. It was about 16 players, so small local tournament. But yeah, that's. It's kind of what you get in these little neighborhoods around Seattle. Like sometimes you can only get about 16 people, but that was a pretty good showing for where we live. So,
yeah, definitely.
Right on. Thank you so much, Brian, for commentating with me, and you know, hopefully we'll get to do some more commentating together in the future.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, excellent, and we'll see you guys next time on Hidden Assets.